Okay, guys. I decided to start the stream just a little bit early so that I can see if everything sounds okay, first of all. Today's like a pretty hot day. The last entire week, I would say, has been pretty hot here. Like, it's been close to 90 degrees, but every single day has had periods of like really, really, really hot sun. And then a thunderstorm, like every single day this week. So right now, it's bright and sunny outside and it's kind of super hot in here. So we have like the exhaust fan going at 100%. There's probably a lot of loud noise stuff going on outside the greenhouse because, you know, every 17 years the cicadas come out. And so we've got like cicadas and a bunch of crickets or something just making all kinds of annoying insect noises. So in chat, let me know if you can hear me okay, if I have to turn up the volume just a little bit. That would be really helpful. Okay, so another thing is, I know that like the stream is about 30 seconds behind, so I will get your comments on how the sound is in a few seconds here. All right, I should probably go over how these live sales work for the folks that are new to this. The live show exists on both Tidal Gardens and on YouTube. And so if you just wanted to participate in the live portion of the chat, it's currently 1:56 p.m. Eastern. So if you're watching it at any other time, it's probably you're watching not the live version, but the published show after we're all done here. But if you did want to participate in chat and all that, you can hop onto YouTube and there's usually like a little chat window where everybody can say hi's and hellos and whatnot. If you actually wanted to purchase corals, the place to do that along with this live sale is tidalgardens.com, and there's a link to the actual live sale page in the top left navigation. There's like a blinking red dot that says live sale. And you can find like a link to this video as well as all of the items in there. To actually get an item, you have to complete the checkout process, not just have it in your cart. So some of these items might move kind of quickly. It kind of depends. In the summer, it's a little bit more slow. So if you complete the checkout, and to avoid getting charged shipping each time, just go ahead and select like the local pickup / live sale option, and just make sure that you paid for shipping once. If your order is over $255, you don't have to worry about shipping, it's free. I think that pretty much covers the rules. If anybody has any questions later, I'm sure that somebody in chat or else I might see it and I'll answer. Do you have any DOA guarantee? Yes, unless it's something extremely egregious, we take care of it. Just drain sounds in the background. That's good. Yeah, unfortunately, I can't do anything with the drain sounds. We have one system here that's pretty much right by my head, and if I turn off the pumps, the sump overflows, which is a lesson that you should have a sump big enough to handle the overflow from the tank. In this particular tank, it's like 1,000 gallons, and it's dumping into like a 150-gallon sump, and that's not quite enough. All right. I should say some thank yous to the Patreon crowd. We had a new patron, Phil, that... So to get onto this this Patreon shout-out, it's like it's $5. So Phil has actually been... donating for a little while now, but this is the first month that he went over the $5 threshold to get a shout out on here. So everybody else has been patrons for over 5 months, which is pretty cool. So thanks Nate, Louise, and Jeff. So yeah, if you wanted to do Patreon, it's kind of like a donation site for YouTube creators. You absolutely don't have to, obviously, like this is a live sale. This is just something extra if somebody just wanted to contribute. Because making videos is kind of no joke. If I buy something, could I pick it up at the CC monthly meeting? Yeah, that's like next weekend, so sure, that's no problem. What is the Patreon link? I think it's patreon.com/tidalgardens. Just throw that in chat. Actually, I don't even know if any of these things link correctly or anything in chat, but out of curiosity, I'm just gonna copy and paste that to see if that works. Yeah, that works. Yup. So anyway, thanks again to you guys. All right, so it's 2:00. We can get started on the actual live show. So the first coral up here is a tricolor oleophilia. These guys are the maize brain corals. Let's go on to number 2. This is a snow-capped pectinia. I am gonna kind of keep a slightly faster pace this time around, partly because this greenhouse is outdoors, and all those like crickety sounding things and the cicadas and stuff also come with mosquitoes, and I want to get out of here before I completely get killed by those. Does Miss Saltwater Tank buy from you? Well, not really, because she's located in England and we only ship to the US. However, she does run like a monthly contest, and the US winner does get a gift card from me. I think the UK winners get like a gift card from a company over there, something like that. She's in this chat. She can answer for herself once she shows up. Okay, next up, number 3. This is a reverse prism favia. So the difference between favia and favites is that favia tend to have much larger polyps, grow quite a bit more slowly. Okay, number 4. This is a lobophilia that we picked up the other day. It's kind of got some purple / fuchsia and some green going on as well. It even has like some pink fluorescence like right around the mouth. So if you're kind of curious like what that lighting change is, we shine an LED flashlight just to get a different type of fluorescence going on, because you're seeing most of this stuff under just pure T5. Bruce, I don't really have a favorite coral, I don't think. It's different at different times. It's kind of like if what's your favorite song? It's different. All right, let's move on to number 5. This is an orchid favites. These guys have like a pinkish purple center, and then this green striping along the outside of the polyp. Do I like canister filters? No, not really. I mean, they're really good for what they do, but to leave it on the tank all the time, I'm not quite a big fan of that, because they kind of run the risk of turning into nitrate factories. But if you were just gonna use it like as a spot cleaning system, where you're like doing like a big water change or something, or you're stirring a bunch of stuff up, and you want to just to micron filter it all out in a one session, I think canister filters are great for that sort of thing. All right, moving on, number 6. This is a red and green favites. These guys have really bright fluorescence. Yeah, those bright green eyes just light right up. Okay. Number 7. It's a toxic green phyvites. Unfortunately, I don't know of any stores in Berlin. I've never actually been to Germany. But that might change at some point. Like, people always ask if I go to, like, Magna, Reefapalooza, and in reality, I don't really attend very many trade shows in general. But there is one trade show that I am kind of, I want to go to eventually, and that's called, what is it called? I'm drawing a blank. What's the big pet show that goes on in Germany every few years? It's like a, it's Interzoo, I think. Yeah, Interzoo. And it's not just a reef tank related, it's for the, pretty much the entire pet hobby. Okay, number seven. That was seven? Oh, you know what? My bad. So, okay, stay on number seven for a sec. Okay, that guy's a toxic green phyllites. I must have just not clicked. So, my bad. Hopefully that doesn't screw up somebody's order. All right. Let's go on to number eight. And hello, Miss Saltwater Tank. Everybody's... Like, the most famous person that's actually on this show is probably her, not me. Okay, so this guy, number eight, is a violet and green phyllites. Yeah, Interzoo. I'm thinking of going one of these years because I'm interested in like the cat stuff. I'm like a crazy cat person. So more than the reef aquarium stuff, I'm just gonna hang out in the cat section. All right, number nine. These are some Bowser zoas. So these always look to me like. What do you call it? Like the Fiji rainbow ones, but I think they just have like more amped up colors. And so right now, I didn't introduce like who's actually helping out. We have a short staff today, so it's just Luke and myself. And so Luke is operating the camera, and actually my mom's on chat occasionally. But if nobody buys number nine, I'm 100% sure by the end of the show, Luke is going to take it home. So here's your only opportunity. Sorry for the people watching this after the fact. Okay, number 10. These are the Utter Chaos Zoas. What kind of flashlight are you using to highlight the corals? We are using, it's a little LED flashlight made by Orphek. O-R-P-H-E-K. I think they're like $50 on Amazon or something like that. All right, moving on, number 11. We have a bunch of different types of Leptosiris today. So this is the first of them. This is a jack-o'-lantern. Do I like DIY projects? A little bit. I'm not that crafty though, to be perfectly honest, so I don't tend to do them too often. Number 12. It's another jack-o'-lantern. So they're these irregular shapes because they grew onto like a flat surface off of their plug. And as a result, like they kind of like spread onto that. So that outer edge is really fragile. And so if it happens to chip, it's kind of fragile. The main body is the only thing that's really growing on a heavy substrate. All right, let's go to number 13. All the tanks are, I would say it's custom, not necessarily DIY. I mean, it's do it yourself, right? So, should be there. Okay. Yeah, welcome everybody. I see different people actually show up in chat every single time we do this. Like there's a couple different people here and there. So welcome, glad you could finally make it. What am I eating? So I'm eating, hopefully you guys can see it. They're milk chocolate espresso beans. So I'm probably gonna get more and more hyper as this show goes on. All right, is this number 13 here? Okay, let's go on to number 14. Which is the second, is it the second or third, second ultra leptoceras? Leptoceras are like insanely fast growing, and all of them, like you can probably see, have grown off of their original plug, which is about an inch, and then onto the plate. And like I said, if it happens to chip a little bit on that plate, it's super thin, so just be warned. You can always just glue that down too. It's not like it's gonna die. Is that beer in the jug? No. Number 15, let's go to that. It's a green Spartan Leptosiris. These are a little bit overexposed, might have darkened it just slightly. Thanks. Yeah, perfect. So no, unfortunately, this is just water. Like, when it comes to drinking, I'm like only social, totally a social drinker. Having said that, one of my friends is having his birthday. So surgeon friend Dave, I've mentioned him a couple times on stream. He's turning 40, and his whole vacation or his whole birthday weekend is based around like a Michigan beer brewing festival. Okay, let's go on to number 16, the second green Spartan. And this this Michigan enthusiast beer thing, you actually, like, to attend it, you have to be a member of the beer club. So I actually had to join some beer brewing club up there to get VIP access. And so I'm going to guess that the entire weekend there's going to be drinking going on. But nope, not right now. All right, let's go on to number 17. Had a big smile on my face until he said espresso beans should be peanuts. No, espresso beans are amazing. I mean, just coffee in general is amazing. I love coffee. Most people don't know this, but I roast my own coffee beans. That's how crazy I am about coffee. And I get shipped in from a specific farm in Hawaii. So I'm a coffee crazy person. Cats and coffee. Number 18. And that white spot you see, it's probably a starfish on the glass. You can't get more social. This is, it's you and 95 people. Yeah, that's true. It'll probably, the most I think we've ever had on this show, like concurrent viewers, was like 160 something. But I mean, there's like, I mean, summertime's always going to be a smaller crowd. I'm going to guess that most people have to be outside mowing their grass on Saturday afternoon. So I get it. All right, let's go to number 19. Have a Pink Floyd chalice. These guys are usually like really expensive. But yeah, they're pretty cool. How sensitive is Leptosiris to water quality and lighting? Well, they're not that sensitive to lighting. As far as water quality, I mean, I don't think you want to completely neglect it, but we've kept it in tanks that have had nitrates at 50, so I guess it couldn't be that bad. All right, let's go to 20. Yeah, I don't know what's on the bottom of that. Probably just detritus or something. Okay, number 21. This is another red and green Favites. I think we had one of these earlier. Slightly dark. All right. 22. So we call these guys Scarlet and Gray Favites. Usually it's like a 50-50% mix. This one is almost the Scarlet side, but they do kind of get this marbled gray streaks through it as well. Okay, let's move on to 23. Yeah, it's another one. Hello from Sweden. That's one place I still... You know, I really haven't traveled much of Europe. I think I've only been to a couple countries. And at some point I really should take some time to explore a bit. Fan, have you tried Zeovit? I have not personally. One of my customers is doing Zeovit, and I've shown his tank once on my channel, I believe, and I'm probably going to show it once again when he gets his new tank. Number 24. It seems pretty interesting. I mean, I guess I don't really know the inner workings of it, and I haven't tried it personally, but it's something that I would experiment with, I think, if I had like an SPS-only system, like specifically Acropora. I could see where something like that would work out. In his tank, though, it's really bizarre. He got every single coral from us, and a lot of the corals that he got are completely unrecognizable, for better or for worse. So his Acropora, for example, let's go to number 25. His Acropora, for example, are super brightly colored, and they take on weird colorations, like really, really, really bright blue and white. And the white is like healthy. It's just that super contrast. Whereas here, it's more like blue and kind of like a tan color instead of white. But then like his Xenia, it's still alive, but the polyps are literally 1/8 the size of what they are here. So it's kind of strange. Yeah, sorry, there's no shipping outside of the U.S. Okay. Did you shine the fluorescent on this guy yet? Yeah. This one is like a little bit difficult to see the different types of fluorescence, but there's like reds and yellows and greens and stuff like that in there. Okay, let's go to 26. It's a reverse war coral. Okay, 27. I'm not 100% sure what this guy is. This is, I think it might be Leptastria. Luke actually picked out these corals. Let's darken that picture up a bit, because the background light's kind of crazy. Yeah. It's hard to say. I'm honestly, I have no idea where this thing even came from. How to make Favites encrust onto a nearby rock? Pretty much just set it there and just let it grow. Yeah, when it comes to visiting other places, I am more likely to visit a place like India than I am to go to San Diego for MACNA. And it's not that close, even, as far as like the likelihood. There's a chance that, you know, we might do something in that neck of the woods, like Thailand or something. Like, people don't may or may not know, but I'm from Burma, which is between Thailand and India. And at some point, I would like to go back there just to see the reefs and all that stuff. Okay, so number 28 is a Miami Hurricane Chalice. A good friend of mine, this came from his tank. He unfortunately had to bail from the hobby. And so I get all his stuff. And so now you get us all his stuff. 29 is a second Miami Hurricane. These are just a little dark. There we go. Okay, number 30 is a Hollywood Stunner Chalice. These things can change color quite drastically. I've mentioned it in past streams, but depending on the lighting that they get, they can either be like kind of this purple and green look. They could be like all green, or they can even develop, excuse me, frog in my throat. They can even develop orange polyps. How long will the stream go for? It usually goes for about 3 hours, but I'm trying to keep a pretty good pace here to get it under that. Number 31. It's another Hollywood Stunner. A little bit dark. If you haven't already, check out my video on lighting. The last two videos I've done were about the topic. One kind of in general, like an overview, and the other one is kind of highlighting the differences that just lighting can make on a single coral. Not even changing its color over time, but just how to present it. It makes a huge difference. Like, you can completely change the look of an entire tank with just some subtle changes in lighting. All right, 32. This is another Hollywood Stunner. This one you can see is already more green than the previous two. And it was probably just grown in a different tank. David, do chalices expand onto rock? Yes, pretty quickly in fact. So chalices are kind of a mixed bag. You can get very different corals, all called a chalice. These guys here, I think, are Echinopora, and they grow really, really quickly onto pretty much anything they touch. 33 is a pastel chalice. These guys grow quite a bit slower than the Hollywood Stunners. Really cool pink color, and they've kind of got like even like blue flecks throughout the main body and bright orange, bright yellow eyes. What would be a good first coral? If you wanted to play it super safe, you want to stick with stuff like soft corals, mushrooms. You really can't go wrong with that. Okay, 34. These are Hills Have Eyes chalices. They mainly purple with green eyes. Do you have a specific day that you ship out? Most everything's going to ship out on Monday, but if you need a specific day to have this stuff sent, that can be arranged as well. Saturday deliveries are more. They're like $15 more. Okay, let's move on to 35. This guy here is a cosmic chalice. This will change quite a lot depending on the season as well. In the wintertime, they're almost completely black, and they get like these little blue speckles on that black body. I wonder if you like shine a fluorescent at it. Yeah, I can't really tell. Still, it's kind of a cool, cool coloration. All right, moving on, 36. So speaking of my friend that that had taken down his tank, that's kind of a recurring theme in the summertime. You can always find some pretty good deals from people, you know, getting out of the hobby in the summertime. It's a very seasonal hobby. So I just got a text from somebody. I don't have television, so I pretty much watch everything online. But one of the local guys here is on a reality show called Fat and Furious. Have you ever seen that show? Okay. I guess like they like him and his friends like rebuild cars or something like that. Anyway, he just sent me a text that he's selling his tank. So that's where all that comes from. So I got a call from a reality TV star wanting to sell me his tank. All right. Next up, 37. Do I have starfish? Only the stuff that like comes pretty much on Live Rock, like mini brittle stars and stuff like that. Any experience with Kessel? A little bit. He seemed to be pretty nice. I know some people that are happy with him. I personally am kind of moving away from LED and more towards T5 and metal halide. Okay, let's go to 38. This guy isn't quite as open as the one before it. These are candy canes. They're pretty fast growing. You can see how this guy is almost two polyps. He's dividing in the middle there. All right, let's go to 39. Yeah, this guy's a bit puffier. So those are some cobalt candy canes. We have some other ones here. So number 40 is a pinwheel. Number 40? There we go.
Did you skip 39?
Did I? Huh, whoops. So now we're on 40. So there was 37, 38, and 39 were cobalt candy canes. And number 40 is a pinwheel. Care for candy canes? I mean, it's pretty much a middle of the road LPS. There's nothing special that you have to do for anything like that. You can feed them, but you don't really need to, that I've seen. Pretty much they get fed whatever's in the water. We don't go out of our way to spot feed those guys. Yeah. Number 41. And as far as like LPS goes, they're some of the fastest growing. They add heads pretty quickly. I guess adding heads isn't really the correct word. They divide, so each head divides. So you start with one, it turns into two, then four, then eight, that sort of thing. Okay, number 42. These are some neon green candy canes. Of all the candy canes, I'm not really sure which is the most popular. I know a lot of people like just love these neon green ones, but sometimes in certain people's tanks, like green is already abundant, so they want to go for some of the other colors. All right, let's go to 43. Amateur mistake. Got to the end of the slider. The other guy that sometimes helps out, Michael, I always make fun of him when he hits the end of the slider. Why are they called candy canes? I have no idea. They're sometimes called trumpet corals. My mom said that's a better name, trumpet coral. They don't look like trumpets either. Excuse me. Thank you. You sell fish on live sales. No, actually, we don't sell fish, period. Okay, is this guy number 42? Or 43? Okay, 43. It's this guy here. All right, number 44. It's a purple-tipped hammer. This is an Indonesian one. Actually, Luke, while you're on this coral, can you please move the shade cloth over? The shade cloth over. You're getting the glare. So what's happening is there's like this shade cloth that we use because if we don't have that, see that blue thing that goes across there? That's actually the tank across the way. So we have to use this this thing to kind of block off the light that goes there. What's the best way to get Zoas to morph? I don't really know. We've done it once with like a paleothoa. We got a cross between like a purple death and a nuclear green, and we just put the two colonies together. And then one day we had one that was like half and half. Okay. Purple tip Indonesian hammer. Number 45. Another purple tip. So this is one of those ones that I'm almost convinced that it's a frog spawn because it has like the multiple tips, but at the same time it so consistently has these hammerheads as well. I'm not 100% sure what these guys are. Definitely smaller than the previous thing that we showed you. Is there any going to be any true blue zinnia? No, we only have like a couple bits and pieces here and there. And they're actually in a tank right now that has some starfish that I think are eating them. So they haven't been growing that well, go figure. Okay, moving on to number 46. Some more hammers. Yeah, so these are the Indonesian ones. They bud off at their base. How long have I been into reef keeping? Probably 30 years. Okay, let's go to 47. This is a neon green hammer. This is Australian. The Australian ones tend to grow a bit more slowly. Dan, does anyone do live sales like that for fish? I don't think anybody does live sales like this, period. Like, I don't think I've ever seen anybody else do like a video thing. It's not that easy, I'll tell you that right now. It's big on equipment and it's big on production. Okay, number 48. So this is what I would normally consider to be like what a frog spawn looks like. The other one is kind of like more difficult to tell. Yeah, if it were easy, anyone could do it. I mean, I know that like more people are going to be getting into live video. And just talking business for a sec. People have been saying for a long time that, you know, that video is the future. You need to get in on video. Video is already the past. Like, if your company is, like, thinking about getting into video, you're 5 years late to that party. And it's almost, like, expected that you have a video presence now. And it's not, if you wanted to be on the cutting edge, it's not just having, like, good video. It's, you need to have good live video. And a lot of like the, you know, a lot of bigger brands and stuff like that are realizing that, and they all have live video presences now. 49. And not just like, I mean, and not just in this industry. I mean, this industry is usually 10 years behind every other industry when it comes to adopting like marketing and technology. Case in point, if you ever wanted to start up a pet store, let's just say, could you darken that a bit? That's like way overexposed. There you go. If you ever wanted to start start up a pet store, a lot of suppliers out there will ask you for a fax of a Yellow Pages ad to show that you're a real store. And it's like, A, nobody uses a fax machine. I mean, Tidal Gardens has never owned a fax machine. And we started this in 2002. And so that's been 14 years, never sent a fax. And then like a Yellow Pages ad, I mean, who doesn't just immediately take their Yellow Pages book and throw it away as soon as they get it? I mean, that's ridiculous. Number 50. But that is how high tech this industry is. About 90% of it. It's super Stone Age. What's an example of a business doing good live video besides Tidal Gardens? Anything in video games is. There's an entire network called Twitch.tv, which I think last year sold to Microsoft or something for like $2 billion after their first year, because they had basically figured out that people like watching other people play video games. And those folks do live extremely well. 51. This is a gold flake acanthophilia. Sorry, it's a little dark. Yep. Dan, you don't look old and your voice sounds youthful. Thank you. It's all the steroids I'm taking. 50. Yeah. He's growing my head. All right, 52. I wish this guy was propped up, but it's basically a tongue coral. I mean, it's kind of like a variety of plate, except that they grow kind of like an oval shape and gets longer and longer. The red varieties are pretty uncommon. 50. Is that the end of that particular rack? 50. Moving on. Is a live sale good business? I think so. It's quite a bit of work, but it's much less work than some other things you could be doing, I guess. And besides, it's kind of fun. I enjoy this. Do you ever just submerge yourself in your fish tanks and just be one with nature? No, that sounds like that's a good way to get a rash. No. I mean... I know you're just probably joking, but I like to scuba dive and stuff like that, so... In a way, yes. But not in these tanks. These tanks are gross. Any more cool vacation in the works? I don't know, does Michigan count? Does Detroit count? Probably not. So I came across the strangest video the other day, speaking of Detroit. There's this guy driving around like inner city, like ghettos, like hardcore ghettos, with his dash cam from his car running, and just like recording all the crazy stuff that's going on. And Detroit looks legitimately terrifying. Like at night. I mean, there was like, there's these kids out and their bikes are all lit up like Christmas trees. And that was like just like this thing. And it just reminded me of something like from The Purge. And there was like a random fight that broke out at a liquor store. And one guy like just got in his car and just drove through like two other people. and then swung around and tried to run them over again. This is like all caught in this guy's dash cam of just like him driving through like the hood. So yeah, maybe Michigan is pretty exotic. So anyway, back to the show. This is abysmal worm rock. Abysmal worms are the little colorful guys that you see. The underlying coral is parietes. And just in my experience, the parietes portion is very, very slow growing. And I don't know if the abysmal worms are reproducing or not, but they definitely grow larger. Yeah, is that parietes 52 or 53? It's 53. Yeah, sorry about that. Yeah, see, I went to school at the University of Michigan, which is like in Ann Arbor, about 45 minutes away from Detroit. My surgeon buddy that I'm going to be going to visit for his birthday, he's kind of in the Detroit area, but not really. Henry Ford Hospital System. 54, let's go to that. It's a rainbow acanthophilia. And this is like way overexposed right now. Yeah, don't mess with Detroit. Please ship to Portugal. Yeah, sorry. Can't. Not yet, anyways. 55. This is an orchid sign arena. The scariest thing I've ever driven through was like the south side of Chicago. Do you feed abysmal worms? I don't go out of my way. However, our food blend, our frozen food that we make just in-house here, has a lot of rotifers. And I've noticed that a lot of things respond very well to rotifers, like frozen rotifers. Let's go to 56. It's a UFO Micromusa. Similar to an acan, they are typically smaller. However, the ones that have been here a long time tend to have quite a larger polyp than usual. Do you practice acanthophilia so fast, or is it just natural? I've said every coral name 100 times. It's practice. Talking about practice. All right, 57. It's a slightly larger UFO Micromusa. Okay, let's go to 58. It's a green acan barabanki. Probably the largest polyps of the whole Acanthastria genus. You can see how much bigger the polyps are than the previously shown micromusas. Abysmal worms are really cool, but I feel like my wrasse would eat them. It is possible. You going to watch the UFC tomorrow night? Is it tomorrow night or is it tonight? For some reason I thought it was tonight. Here, hold on. I'm gonna look that up. Now you got me curious. UFC 202. It's Saturday, August 20th, right? That's like tonight. Yeah. Am I gonna go watch it? Maybe. I didn't have plans to, but I might. Fifty-nine. It's a rainbow acan barabanki. Not 100% sure these are barabankis at all, but I'm not really sure they're echinadas either. So, flip a coin. Yeah, it's tonight. Or I guess it depends on where you are. I guess it could be tomorrow. Yeah, but it's supposed to be the 20th. That's tonight, Saturday night. Yeah. So in chat, tell me, do you have Diaz or McGregor? Or if you're into another fight that's going on tonight. Okay, let's go to 60. It's another Bauer Banky, possibly, or an Echinada. Okay, that explains it. Yeah, Sunday for those in the UK and Europe. All right, makes sense. I guess I should have clarified. It's like, it's in 10 hours, right? Like, roughly. Okay, let's go on to 61. So this is an A-can Echinada. You see how much bigger the previous guys were? That's why I kind of am hesitant to call them an Echinada. But they don't really have the polyp structure that looks like a Bauer Banky. It might just be a different A-can species altogether that I'm just, like, not that aware of. It's the only fight to watch. That's kind of disappointing. Okay, so moving on to 62. Slightly different colored Micromusa. This one's more orange and green, rather than like that purple and red. Right, going to 63 now. Rookie move. It's also a little bit dark. When it gets, yeah. This is the joys of a greenhouse, like our light changes. And see, now it's going to be too bright because like the sun's going to come beaming back out. I learned so much from watching. Thanks. Yeah, right at this point, you're probably going to get more UFC fight predictions than actual coral information. Which, if I was a betting man, which I'm definitely not, I'd probably go with Nate Diaz. What is the one most important thing you would tell someone starting out with a reef tank? Be patient, and the more research you can do, basically for every day you spend doing research, it'll save you $1,000. Think of it that way. So number 64 here is a Red Sun Acan Lord, Acanthastria lordhowensis. Upgrading to a 75 soon, what's your opinion on deep versus shallow sand bed? Practically no difference. Depends on how much flow you want to put through it as well. Can you say hi to my little one Lily? She likes to watch too. Hello, Lily. You misspelled hi. Alright. Okay, let's go on to 65. This is like super dark looking, Luke. Yeah, sun went away. Go figure. Get a second job? Yeah, you could get a second job. Do you ship anywhere other than the US? Technically, we ship to Puerto Rico, but that's probably not what you were asking for. No, we don't ship outside the US. It's a pain in the butt. Like, I was like looking at, I was doing all this research with FedEx. So I have like my FedEx rep. That, you know, and I'm talking to like their global shipping expert and everything like that, getting all this stuff set up to potentially try out shipping something to the UK. So, and it trust me, it is an expensive, ridiculous expensive ordeal to do this. The entire thought process was once it's in the UK, it's in the European Union, and it can travel easily, more easily throughout the European Union once it actually gets there. While this process is going on, this whole Brexit thing happens, and now like the UK is in this weird holding pattern of like, are they in the UK or are they in the EU or not? It's a political mess. Everybody is like resigning from their top posts. I don't know who the heck runs that country right now. Number 66, let's go to that. It's a green pinwheel A-can. So needless to say, my little foray into international shipping got screwed up because of a vote in Great Britain. Ah, Reef Gardens, just found this channel. Hi from the UK. Hello. Who runs your country right now? Okay, 67, Orange Pavona. Samuel, anyone ever play the Coral Lottery and buy something not shown yet? A long time ago, I used to have stuff on here that was like $1, and people would do that all the time. They just say, oh, it's a dollar. I'm going to take a flyer on that. All right, let's go on to 68. It's a larger Orange Pavona. Okay, let's go to 69. Some bubble SPS. Nice, George. Number 70. Some green Pavona. What is the deal with Pavona? I don't know. Some people like them. Yeah, you get Aptasia for a dollar. So, Coralfish 12G, I don't know if you guys know him, but he's got a pretty cool YouTube channel himself. Check him out. By the way, I let people promote their YouTube channels generally on this channel. So most welcome to give yourself a quick shout out. All right, 71. Another green Pavona. Pavona is like fast growing, and they take on all different types of growth forms. Like the orange ones you saw earlier, they're more of like an encrusting. The green ones form these like vertical plates. They're called cactus coral. And the only one that really kind of looks like a cactus are these green Pavona. There's a purple one, purple Pavona, excuse me, that also forms like vertical plates. Next up, 72. And then like the freak hair, which is like a purple fuchsia base, bright green tentacles. This one's an encrusting variety. I'd say that there's more encrusting varieties than the other types. Okay, let's go to 73. What coral would you say has the worst sting? I've never been stung before by fire coral from the Caribbean, but I hear that's pretty bad. I've been stung before by like a giant carpet anemone, and that one, those are always kind of weird to get stung by. I'll tell you about that in just a sec. Let's go to 74. I mean, you might be asking like, what's the worst sting for another coral to get stung by? In that case, it's probably a chalice of some sort. Those have really, really potent stings. But one time I got stung by a carpet anemone pretty bad, and I would almost swear that I felt it in my heart immediately. And then I found out later that like people can sometimes get allergic reactions specifically to carpet anemones, and they can like have heart attacks or just like die altogether. All right, 75. There's another blue Pavona. Yeah. It might need to be a little bit brighter. Yeah, so these guys are mostly blue, but you can kind of see like a green rim. Do you have a Tidal Garden Snapchat where you could do like daily snap stories of different corals or cool things? I wish. I'm just too busy to do, like, even the social media that we do right now, it's highly neglected, let's just say. Hopefully, we'll be able to fix some of those issues in the coming months here, but we'll see. 76. It's another blue Pavona. And you can kind of see the green rim on this guy a little bit easier. So yeah, so it all depends. Like, there's so much stuff to do in running a business that it's like, you make a list of like the top 10 things that need to be done. Like need to be done. You just choose 7 of those. And those aren't going to get done today. So it's like, yeah, I mean, I would love to have like a stronger social media presence. It's just finding the time and attention to do it all. 77, green Montipore digitata. Wait, really? That's not right. Really? That's not right. That's a... I have no idea what this even would be. I know it's a Spangotis, but like on the website for sale, what is it? 77. Yeah, it should be this. It should be a Spangotis. So let me quickly fix that. Don't know what happened there. These guys usually have like that kind of like a brownish base, but then, or brownish polyps, but then they have like this green base underneath. Yeah, 77 is $20 on the site. Good. That is correct. Is it possible to frag a bubble coral? Kinda. You can run it through a saw. Both halves might survive. Is it worth it? Probably not, considering how kind of slow they grow, and you run the risk of both sides getting an infection. One or both sides. I mean, if you cut a coral in half like that, and half of it gets an infection, all you did was just lose half of a coral, and you're kind of like worse off than you started. Worst case scenario, both halves die. So. We don't typically do stuff like that. Let's see, 79. So I'm on Snapchat, but I'm following an Instagram page who claims they are you. Is that you? Yeah, we're on Instagram. What can you say about digitata care? Well, Montipora in general, they're kind of like acros in that, you know, they'll appreciate high light, high flow, clean water. For those asking about like zeovit, you'll probably get like some crazy coloration of different types of Montipora using a system like that. Greenhouse is impressive. How are the corals of colors through the seasons? Usually better in the winter, to be perfectly honest. Summertime's rough. We get better at it every year, but it's definitely kind of rough. All right, let's go to 80. This is a Mystic Sunset Monty. In the wintertime, for example, I would expect that the base of this guy, he's a bit out of focus as well. Better, yeah. I would expect the base of this to turn almost like a blood red. Right now it's kind of like a purplish color. Let's go to 81. Yeah, you see how this one on that left edge, it's more of a red color. It gets a brighter and brighter red in the winter months. Things like SPS and certain LPS like Acanthastria, they tend to be the most affected by lighting. Okay, let's go to 82. Oh wait, yeah, okay, good. So, almost lost my place there. Could you brighten that image up a little bit, Luke? And I always have to catch myself, because like there's somebody else now helping us out, and his name is Lucas, and there's a Luke. So I always have to like mentally.
I'm Luke S.
Yeah, and he's Luke last initials S. So he's Luke S. I'm just gonna start calling them both Luke and just like scream at quote unquote Luke until the correct one does what I want. Let them figure it out. All right, next up, 83. Do you ever use natural sunlight to grow corals? That's kind of what's happening in the greenhouse. It is natural sun. It's good for some things, bad for other things. Okay, let's go to 84. This is a purple Montipora undata. Hi, any advice on acropora coloration? Yeah, metal halide and T5 lighting will help a lot. Next up, 85. It's a different type of purple undata. There's a couple of different varieties we have, mostly still purple. I've seen really, really nice acropora tanks under LED, but they never seem to have as good a color as the metal halide and T5 setups. And it's almost like you're fighting against... It's almost like the tanks are succeeding in spite of the lighting. Have any experience with a spiky pink sea cucumber? Mm-mm. No. Okay, 86. It's another green digi. LEDs do nothing for them? No, I wouldn't say that. I mean, LEDs work. Like, all lighting works. So, you know, people might debate, like, well, my corals grow perfectly under... Corals growing is an incredibly low bar for success. I mean, our corals are extremely adaptable, and they will try very hard to stay alive if you let them, and they'll do their best. They'll do their part, let's just say. In terms of trying to get them to their optimum crazy coloration, or you're looking for like a specific trait, there's probably better ways to do that than with LED. Now, having said that, most people buy LEDs for completely different reasons than that. I mean, and like, completely valid reasons, like energy efficiency, control, things along those lines. Nothing's going to beat LED for that. And so if that's like a high priority for you, it almost like, yeah, I mean, that should be your buying decision right there. Let's go to 87. But if you're looking for what I think is like the best in terms of getting corals colored up, it wouldn't be LED. A little bit brighter, please. Any specific color temp in T5? Not really. In fact, you might be better off to color up corals under stuff that looks to your eye like less aesthetically pleasing. For example, like true actinic, the stuff that's actually kind of dipping into like the near UV and all that stuff, it's a very, very ugly, dull purple. Like, it makes your stuff look worse, but it might be better for the corals. Conversely, the stuff that's more yellow looks kind of ugly, but it might be better for your corals. So you kind of have to make the choice. Is it like, am I lighting this for my personal enjoyment, or am I lighting it for growth and coloration? Those two things might be different. Let's go to 88. It's a purple sand dollar Monty. So, I mean, you can get a good compromise. Like, I personally like the ATI Blue Plus. I always just like that aesthetic. And right now, we just set up a couple of fluorescent fixtures, like with half Coral Plus and half Blue Plus. And it looks kind of nice, but that's just, I mean, aesthetics is always going to be subjective. Okay. Let's go on to 89. Scarlet Montipora. I always like the little purple dots in the middle of these of each individual polyp. And in terms of lighting, again, nowadays there's fixtures where you don't have to choose between one technology or another. You can just get a fixture that has all of it together. So ATI makes power modules, which are LED and T5, for example. Let's go to number 90. I think Reef Bright makes fixtures that are T5 and LED, and I think they even make one that's like metal halide and LED. So you can get pretty much any combination that you're looking for. I've never seen a fixture that does LED, T5, and metal halide, or the ones that do only use the LEDs for like moonlighting or something. Like an Odyssey has LEDs that are just moonlights, but I'm sure, and you can also retrofit, that's also a possibility. So I mean, you don't have to choose one thing or another. But if you did have to choose, it kind of depends on what sort of features you're looking for, I guess. Let's go to number 91. Will different Montipora species sting each other? Possibly. I've seen most corals here do battle, and most everything fights like crazy. Then I've seen other people's tanks where stuff is like growing on top of one another without any issues. So that might be like a husbandry thing. Like I might be doing something wrong in that case, because they're having like multiple colonies of different stuff all over each other. Don't know what that's all about, because if that happened in my tank, every single one of those colonies would be dead. Okay, and removing the camera again. Anyone gone for the new Radeons yet? I personally have not. Actually, I replaced, so Luke here got four of my Radeons. They were acting up on me. Like, so one night, we have security cameras here. Go figure. Most places have security cameras, right? So I'm looking at footage on my security camera, and at like middle of the night, all of a sudden there's like a light on, and it's like this flashing light. It comes on for 2 seconds, goes off for 5 seconds, on for 2 seconds, off for 5 seconds. I'm like, huh. And it turns out that, well, that's one of my Radeons, just doing that all night long. I have no idea what that's all about. So I went and I'm like, okay, well, maybe it just needs to be like restarted or something. And so I like reconnected it all, did the whole software thing, and then set it to like a program. I'm like, oh, great. And so then that night at about 10 o'clock, I was like, yeah, let's just check to make sure. All right, I need to change the overlay while I'm jibber jabbering. So this is a green, like a four screen acro. So let's just check the security cameras again to see if it's still having that flashing issue. Well, no, it's not having the flashing issue. The lights are just on 100%, and it's like the middle of the night. So whatever program it thought it was on, it's just on 100%. So the very next day, I'm sure it's just like a software issue, but I lose patience for stuff like that. And so I just yanked them all down, and they're now Luke's problem. Are they working, by the way? Did you get them working yet?
No.
Oh.
I have to go to school.
Okay. All right, so number 93. Yeah, so I for my purposes, on off, works really, really, really nicely. Okay. Number 94. It's a tiny little forest green, and it's a little bright. So you just needed to go to the store to get a micro USB to plug in the light. Oh yeah, did you contact Ecotech?
No, I read it.
Oh, just read about it. If you sign up for the email, it will notify you when the next live sale happens. Yes. That's probably the best way to stay in touch. Because, like, the worst way, honestly, is, like, Facebook. Like, Facebook doesn't even, like, so I have, like, something like 7,000 or 8,000 followers on Facebook. If I post something on Facebook, like, tens of people might see that post. It's just how Facebook works. They want me to like pay them money They're basically holding all my Facebook people hostage, and so I have to pay a ransom for them to see my posts. So I'm like, so I'm sorry, Facebook crowd, but you guys get the bare minimum of my effort. Okay, let's go to 95. What's the ugliest coral in my opinion? I don't know.
A dead one,
yeah. That's a good point. So this purple bonsai, it's kind of strange in that it's almost all green. You're going to see one later that it's going to have more of that purple-green contrast. A lot of the ones we have are either all purple, or usually they're almost always all purple with like just the green polyps, but the growth edge is bright green. So this one here, the growth edge is practically the whole colony right now. Do you use a sunrise and sunset mod? If you're talking about the Radeons, it was one of their default programs. I think it did do sunrise, sunset. It's supposed to. But for the rest of my stuff, it's just no on-off. Okay, let's go to number 96. Merlin McDonald, do SPS really need that much flow? In my experience, flow really did help. And I've seen, and just for like full disclosure, we keep our flow a lot less than what I would like. And in tanks that I've seen that really have a lot more flow, I think they look better than what I've got going on. By the way, in this acropora that you see those little stringy things coming off of the polyps? That is the coral feeding. And I'm going to do a video on this sort of thing later on. But we feed rotifers, and certain of our acros, they all get these like streamers whenever we do this. So I'm going to shoot a time lapse, and I'm going to see if we can actually see them consuming what comes off of those streamers. Okay, 97. Could be. Any advice on quarantining corals? I think it's a great practice. Everyone should do it. And me being a hypocrite, I kind of don't do it. We kind of ran out of floor space when we were designing this greenhouse. If we ever do switch to like a bigger or different location, a big quarantine system, I think, is going to be really necessary. Because like there's stuff that like people say, oh, you just dip your stuff. Dips handle at best a third of your problems. There's a lot of things that survive the traditional coral dips. A lot of things survive. So let's go to number 98. You can't really just rely on that sort of thing. And you want to be able to then take corals that do have issues and move them into a quarantine tank and either have the issue dealt with there or at the very least, just get it away from the rest of your stuff. Okay, let's go to number 99. Yeah, so this is that other purple bonsai that I mentioned earlier. See how he's a lot more purple. Okay, and let's go to number 100. And this is a purple and blue Acropora Taraki. I need to take a 2 second bathroom break. I'll be right back. Too much of this stuff. Be back. Thank you. Say what?
They're melting.
You're melting?
Yeah.
My chocolates are melting. Okay. One sec, I need to fill up. Gotta get the fill up. Gotta hydrate. Let's see, catching up on chat. I have a question for Van. Zoas might have been closed for a month now, but the Zoas right above them are open. Why is that? Okay, yeah, let's go to 101 real quick. Smaller Taraki frag. It could be a pest. So there's a lot of things that bother zoanthids. It could be, you know, any number of things that might like jump on and start messing with the zoa. And certain zoas are susceptible to different ones. So it could be something worth, like, if you can grab it and dip it, you might see something jump off. So like something like Coral RX or Revive. There's a bunch of different ones you could try. Yeah, this is my fake Yeti. Somebody in chat mentioned that. You can see it from a mile away. All right, 102. This is an Acroportenius. Okay, next up, 103. Some frog skin Acroporas. How's your, that Acroportenius, how's yours doing?
Oh, it looks awesome.
Yeah? Because, like, in person, this one here doesn't really look like anything to me, but on stream it showed up really nicely just now. Yeah. We do not have optimal Acropora keeping conditions here. But it's getting better, it's getting better. All right, next up, 104. Yeah, let's go to 105. What's a good coral dip? I mean, we use a lot of Coral RX here. Do I really need to dip my corals? It's a decent idea. Nothing is 100%. The thing that is probably the best thing is a lengthy quarantine. Which nobody likes to do. Yeah, just go ahead. I mean, something as simple as like algae growth on zoanthids could keep them closed. I mean, there's a lot of things that bother zoas. Somebody online, you can never trust these online people, but they said that just increasing their light intensity helped a lot to get zoanthids to respond and grow or to flesh out. Yes. Go the other way. sorry, chat. I'm like actually enjoying this. I'm gonna see if you can figure it out.
Oh God, no!
It's like No, it's not perfect. Other way. No. I mean, like, turn the barrel the other way. Turn. Oh, there you go. You're so smart. This place is a hostile work environment, if you didn't already know. Okay. Yeah, you're getting some love on the chat now. Oh boy. All right, let's go on to 107 after all that. So I think this might be the first time we've shown this guy on stream before. I mean, you've seen like a lot of the forest greens before, you've seen blueberries before. We have tons and tons of that. But this guy here is very, very strange. I don't quite remember where we got it from, even. But it's like this purple on purple, but usually the polyps are like way like bigger and fatter than all the other acros. And it grows, I don't know, like, imagine you have like a plastic glove and you just blow air into it and it kind of just extends out like that. That's kind of what it looks like. All right, next up, number 108. Forest green. And again, you can see those little streamer thingies. I think it's the acro is just catching rotifers. Do you think one spot fox face and a coal tang would get along at a 75? Yes, probably. All right, next let's go to 109. This is a rainbow Postellopora. I think it's the only one that we have on the live show here. Sometimes we have a couple. Any zoas during this live sale? Did I miss them? No, we usually end the show on different types of zoas. So like the last 30 or so, I'm gonna guess. All right, let's go to 110. We only had two so far. It was the two big budget ones. It was the Bowsers and the Outer Chaos, yeah. Okay. Number 111. It's a neon green stylo. Okay, 112. All right, next up, 113. It's a purple stylo. I happen to like stylos a lot for some reason. I think it's because they're like kind of uniformly fluffy. Do you know anyone that's gotten hurt by zoa toxins? Unfortunately, I do. Let's go to 114. There's a local reefer, and he got zoa poisoning, and it really, really, really messed him up. Like, he has all kinds of health issues as a result. Like, I mean, even like memory problems and stuff. I mean, people consider palytoxin. Like a nerve agent, but it's more than that. It's like cytotoxic and stuff, meaning it kind of has like properties of like chemotherapy. So like it kills off like cell growth and stuff, in addition to like being a neurotoxin. So there's like many different ways to feel sick as a result of palytoxin poisoning. Let's go to 115. And so he was actually talking to like the Center for Disease Control, even. They were really interested in like, you know, getting an idea of like what he was going through as a result of all that. So he's alive and feeling better, but I think that there's still some effects from that. And that was like years ago when that happened. Next up, 116. Another guy, and I might be misremembering this, but do you guys know about Reef Central? It's a very big, popular online forum. Anyway, one of the guys that runs it, his name's Ryan. He's actually local to Ohio. And he was fragging zoanthids, and I think that his dog, like, just put his head into the bucket. I don't know if it licked anything or what, but that dog ended up dying, like, that same evening. All right, next up, 117. Can you get poison from just touching them? No, not really. You pretty much have to get polytoxin into your bloodstream. What do you use for biological filtration? Nothing really. I mean, we just use protein skimmers and water changes. Okay, next up, 118. It's a yellow bird's nest. Do you have any dead coral and mud setups? No mud setups. I'm not really sure what the dead coral setup would be. Okay, let's go on to 120 in a moment. It's going to be a bird of paradise once we get there. See how fast Luke can focus. Much better. Yeah.
All the chocolates are melting.
You can put them in the freezer, yeah. You don't have to. You can just eat them. You can just eat them. Okay. What lights are you using? These are T5s right now. There's still some LED in the greenhouse. I mean, actually, there's probably more LED in the greenhouse right now than there is T5. But making a slow trend. Sorry, forgot to change the overlay. This is 120. It's a bird of paradise. We're switching to a lot of T5. And I'm debating on. So here's the thing. I like ATI. I mean, I did some videos about their actual bulbs and stuff like that, and I've been very, very impressed with their fixtures. Okay, let's go to 121. Here's the thing, though. I go on Amazon, and I found like a 4-foot, 4-bulb fixture that is damp condition rated that comes with 4 bulbs. Granted, they're like, you know, horticultural yellow bulbs for $75, and that includes 2-day prime shipping from Amazon. That is really, really, really cheap. So I went, sure, let's give it a try. And you know what? Sure enough, the light bulbs turn on. So I'm gonna see how long they last, because for $75, like, come on, so cheap. Let's go to 122. So here I am thinking, I mean, I really do like the ATI fixtures. A comparable, quote unquote comparable, sun power fixture is like $500 or $600, and they don't come with light bulbs. I mean, granted, I'm just gonna swap out all the light bulbs anyway, but still, that's a big difference in price. And if these things like happen to not work that well and they break, you can replace it for $75 shipped. So, I don't know. Okay, next up, 123. Would you say a protein skimmer helps out with coral growth? I think anything you can do to help process nutrients and keep nitrates and phosphates lower is going to help. That goes back to the, you know, good lighting, good water flow, good water quality. If you do all those three things, you're going to get good coral growth. And again, coral growth is a really low bar for success. 124. Let's move on to that. It's a pink stylo. Another stylo. Okay, 126. It's a slightly larger pink Postellophora colony. So I was thinking about doing this video on symbiotic relationships. So I made like kind of like a wish list of these things that I wanted to highlight. Let's go to 127. And so I bought all these little critters and everything like that, and I put them into different tanks. And now I can't find any of them. So there's like a porcelain crab, don't know where he is. There's a Yasha goby and a pistol shrimp, don't know where they are. Actually, I know where the goby is. I haven't seen the shrimp like ever again. There's a little pom-pom crab, don't know where he is. Let's go to 128. It's a pink Postellophora. Slightly different coloration on this guy. Would you agree on using LED lighting for SPS? You can. I know a lot of people that do. That wouldn't be my first choice. Do you use a waterproof camera? Not regularly. The only time I ever do that is if I wanted to take a picture of something in the tubs, or if I'm diving, which is pretty rare. Everything else is done in with a cinema camera, which is what's shooting the corals right now. Is a cinema camera. Okay. Moving the rig. Yeah, so hopefully I'll be able to find all these little critters that I bought and shoot a nice video for you guys to kind of like highlight some cool symbiotic relationships. But so far, how cool can they possibly be if you can't even see them ever? We'll see. Hopefully. All right, what's this 129? This is a pink or an orange plating Monty. Doing a 10-gallon water change in a 60-gallon tank? That sounds fine. Perfectly reasonable. 130. So the plating Monty's, in my opinion, are the fastest growing of all the different Monty's. Really fast growing, really easy to keep as far as SPS goes. And the cops are here, or at least they're in the background. So we live on like I guess it's a county road or it's a state road, but there's always like sirens all the time here. Okay, next up, 131. Similar coloration, but this has like a much deeper red color than the orange. How long does the stream go for? How much longer? It's gonna go, so we're on 131 right now. I think the last item is in the low 200s, so it should go on for maybe another hour. What webcam am I using? It's just whatever's on this laptop here. $132. Let's go to that. Yes, we have a Facebook page. It's just Tidal Gardens, facebook.com/Tidal Gardens. I've got a love hate with Facebook going on. All right, let's go to 133. This is a green plating, Monty. It almost looks like it has a little bit of a purple rim going on, but it might just be the lighting there. Yeah, the cops are always coming to get me. I don't think there is such a thing as overkill and protein skimming. All right, let's go to number 134. I am big on big skimmers. All right, so those are green plating Montes. 135 here is a neon green plating Monte, and you can kind of see the difference. This one's pretty bright. It's a little bit overexposed though. Any noticeable difference between Montes under T5s and LEDs? Less so. I mean, I think that like the plating Montes, you might not see that big of a difference. They're not quite as picky. I think you're more likely to see that for like acros and things like A-cans. Let's go to 136. This is a yellow scroll. This is a product of lighting. So brighter lights are going to get you more yellow. Right now it's only giving you like the yellow polyps and a more of a purple base. You can, depending on the amount of light you give it, you can turn the entire thing yellow. Lower light will give you this look. Okay, let's go to 137. It's a smaller yellow scroll. The biggest problem that I think with like T5s and metal halides is just like the electrical consumption bulb replacement costs. I mean, it's like the cost of ownership is quite a lot more than LED. Okay, next up, 138. And I don't want to give the impression that like you cannot keep things under LED. That's ridiculous. You can keep anything you want under LED. I mean, we're basically talking about that last little bit of optimization. It's like, what is a thing that would bring out the best color? I mean, that's usually what people are arguing about. I mean, if we're talking about stuff that just like growth, can I grow blank coral under blank light? The answer is almost always going to be yes. I mean, it's like me congratulating Luke for getting a coral in focus with a camera. That's like, you kind of expect that, you know, it's just, come on now, that's not a high bar of success here. You just turn the barrel slightly and boom, it's in focus. That's like growing coral under any kind of light. It'll grow. That's, if somebody can't grow any coral under any light, you're doing something else wrong. It's really not the lighting. 139. These are toadstool leathers, by the way. We have different types of toadstools. Do you ship international? No, unfortunately, we don't. Only the US. Two skimmers in the sump. That's interesting. I've had people try that before, not with great results. So let other folks know how well that goes for you. Usually one skimmer works and the other one doesn't. All right, let's go to 140. These past three toadstools are the same variety. And I think this next one might be different, number 141. Yeah, slightly different one. This one's base has like a more of a green sheen to it. Okay, let's go to 142. Bumped it over. So this, I believe, is similar to 141 that I just showed. The difference is that this guy is going through his shedding period. So every few weeks, month or so, leather colonies, especially like the big sarcophytons, they'll get like a waxy coat, close up entirely, and it's almost like this like saran wrap film builds up on them. And they do this and they shed that off to kind of remove any kind of like algae that's been growing on them. So that's like a normal process. Just make sure that it gets enough flow for it to then kind of like shed its skin, and then it comes out and it's fully extended. Okay, so this guy here is 143. It's a neon green tipped toadstool. Why not LED and T5? No reason, you can do LED and T5. In fact, like ATI's power module is LED and T5. Great fixture. Nothing wrong with that. And if you watched my like last video, let's go to 144. My last video, one thing is if you like the look of LED, which by the way, I think that LED shows off the coral the best. Like I really like that all blue look. If you like that look, but want to have like some T5 to help color up the corals, you can always get like a really inexpensive fixture. Like, you know, I said $75 can get you a 4-bulb fixture on Amazon. Just run that thing for like 4 hours a day when you're not home, on a timer if you want, and just, yeah. And it's by the time that you do come home, it's already off. You can enjoy the light aesthetically that you like, while giving the corals what they needed during the day. You can always do something like that. Okay, next up, 145. There's a lot of people from the UK here today. Have you noticed that? Welcome, guys. How's life outside of the EU? I'm still roasting on that. Okay, number 146. Got some $5 Kenya trees. How much salt do you use for water changes in a month? I don't know. So it depends. Sometimes we use about 200 a week to 600 a week, depending on season. So in a month, that could be like a whole bunch. Let's see. Let's go to 147. Another $5 Kenya tree. LED is the most cost-effective option. Probably. LED prices are coming down. And I think that the technology is getting better. And you're more likely to see improvements in LED technology versus T5 and metal halide, which I expect to see no improvements in technology with those two. Norway here, we're not in the EU and it's great. I bet. Like the Scandinavian countries, it's like, I think you guys got it pretty good. I've never visited, but I hear good things. Okay, next up, 148, some green star polyps. So somebody was asking about like, you know, good beginner corals, any of these like leathers, green star polyps, zoas, that sort of thing. Those are mushrooms, all are good options. Okay, next up, 149. And 150. And so 150 is like the smaller guy there. And they have a slightly different center than the balloon variety that we just showed you. No, I didn't know that. Okay, next up, 151. Charles Kessler, what's a good light schedule? I've kind of found that lower photo periods seem to have done pretty well. So if I was to do a home aquarium, I would probably do like a maximum, like absolute maximum of 8 hours. And the brighter period of that, maybe only about six. Eric Rodriguez, the Ecotech return pump, I remember seeing if you guys are starting to use them. Yeah, we have, we actually had them on all five of our systems, and one of them actually gave us some trouble. Like the impeller just seized on it. And the pump was like less than a month old. Now Ecotech, to their credit, like they sent a new pump, which is great. Let's go to 152. But that just goes to show you should have like a backup, because I mean, any pump at any price point can fail for no good reasons. And like, even if the manufacturer does everything right, like what else could they do other than give you a new pump, right? But that's like 3 days just in the mail, and you need to have a backup. So always plan ahead for that. Luckily, we have like a million pumps sitting around, so we can be fine. But yeah, otherwise they seem to be okay. I mean, they're pumps, they're quiet. All right, next up, 153. How many corals do you frag a week? I don't know, lots. Of 10 hours of light, too much? Nah. I mean, if it works for you, that's great. Just keep doing what works for you. All right, let's go to 154. We're now going into our mushrooms. Bring a lot of money if you took a trip to Norway. Kind of high prices, yeah. I hear that could be a thing. Okay, story time. I wanted to go dive in the Red Sea. And there's not that many places where you can go to dive in the Red Sea. Let's go to 155. It'll be a purple redactus once we get there. So like places like the Sudan, probably not. Saudi Arabia, not really feeling that. I don't know what else is out there, like Iran. Like, basically places you kind of can't go. Then there's Egypt. And I'm like, well, Egypt, possibility. So I looked up vacation packages to Egypt, right? And the price that I found, get this, for 1 week, let's go to 156. 1 week, all-inclusive resort on the Red Sea with air flight included was $600. And I'm like, wow, that is a really good price. I can't get to Chicago for that deal. But I can get to Egypt for that deal. And I'm like looking into it, and it's like, there's some sketch, you know? There might be a lot of people walking around with AK-47s. There might be some ISIS activity. So the price is not the problem. Price is not the problem, but everything else might be. Let's go to 157. And then we have this like family friend who's actually from Egypt, and he basically said, yeah, it's not a good idea right now. Not a good idea. I think we need to darken that up quite a bit. Israel, possibly. So I have like another company that I do like fitness media. And one of my business partners, he's Israeli. And he's like, yeah, you can go to Israel. And they do diving there. Technically, that's not the Red Sea. It's like a gulf of Aqaba, I think. And I would consider that, because you can get to that from either Israel or Jordan, both places of which is a lot safer than Egypt, from what I understand. Yeah, Sharma Sheikh, I think that's what it's called. Yeah, Egypt. That's where a lot of those resorts I saw. Okay, next up, 158. What salt do you guys use? We use
Omega
C. That's what we use. are zinnias hard to control from spreading throughout the tank? Not difficult to control. You can always just remove them. They'll either try to take over your tank or they're just going to die. There's really nothing in between. Where's Tidal Gardens? It's in Ohio, in the U.S. Okay, next up, 150. Some orange redactuses here. So yeah, Israel might be a possibility. I'm actually more interested in going to Jordan, because I want to see Petra. Let's go to 160. There's a blue spotted discosoma. These are pretty neat. So I'm like the least. So when it comes to like what things do you look for in a salt, I guarantee you that every single thing that you guys list is going to be different than what I look for in a salt. The number one thing I look for is, can you put it on a pallet, send it to me on a short truck with a lift gate for pretty cheap? That's like the number one buying decision thing for me. Like, don't really care about the consistency of the chemistry. Don't care about any of that stuff that like other people generally would want to care about. Like, how good is your salt? I don't care. How well can you deliver it to me in pallet quantities is what I care about. Okay, 162. And having said that, we've been running Omega C now for about over a year. It's pretty good. Is it better than something else? I don't really know. I don't think that anybody could tell the difference between this and when we were running Instant Ocean, for example. Any jawbreakers? No, I wish. All right, 163. Actually, Olga, are you from Israel? I forget. I think you might have mentioned where you were from before. I just don't remember. Oh, by the way, this is my favorite mushroom. It's also the most expensive one on this show, but it's by far my favorite. I love this thing. Where do the discosoma mushrooms come from? Most of them are going to be either from Indonesia or Australia. I kind of lost track after all these years. All right, let's go to 164. Okay, so Olga is from Israel. Yeah, actually, like I said, my business partner, who's he's Israeli, he goes over there at least once or twice a year, visiting family and stuff. And my mom has lived in Israel before. How long were you there? 6 months. Oh, not that long. Next up, 165. Some different gorgonians. These are all photosynthetic. Provide them plenty of flow, plenty of light. They'll do well. The hardest thing about gorgonians is just getting them to attach after you cut them. They don't like to stick, so you have to kind of finagle them quite a bit. Okay, 166. It's a purple candelabra sea fan. Yeah, Samuel, all of these are Caribbean sea fans. I don't mess with the Pacific ones anymore. They're like, you're just asking for heartache. Unless you have a system that's really well designed to provide like constant feeding for those things, it's a mess. The Caribbean ones are like super easy in comparison. All right, let's go to 167 in a moment. It's gonna be an orange helmet fungia once we get there. Actually, another bathroom break. Ouch. Cramped quarters here. Okay. Is it messed up that I want that heartache? No, they're really cool looking, like Pacific Oregonians, but the amount that you have to feed them is absurd. You have to provide good water quality and crazy amounts of feeding. All right, let's go to 168. It's a green helmet. They're called the helmets because they're kind of like dome-shaped. And then let's go to 169. And on to 170. Yeah, so red fungia plates are, they tend to be some of that color is one of the most difficult colors to get. Okay. Next up, 171. Got some Galaxia. I always mention the warning about these guys. You have to kind of watch out for sweeper tentacles. They tend to extend those pretty far. You know, one thing I just never really noticed until now is that the lower tentacles are purple and the ones closer to the mouth are green. That's kind of neat. 172. Slightly smaller colony. All right, 173. Well, it just occurred to me also that we've been on for 2 hours now, so making pretty good pace. We'll probably be done before 3 hours. So these guys are pipe organs. They kind of look like cloves, kind of look like green star polyps, but they're pretty distinctive. 174 is a purple pipe organ. Did chat just die? No one said anything for a while now. And let's go to 175, which are these blue/green sympodium. Like the polyps themselves, the tips of each tentacle is kind of green. The main body and the centers are all blue. Okay. Next up, blue lithophyllon. I'm gonna reload the chat to see if, nope, seems to be working. Because everybody got quiet. Hello? So quiet. Yeah, we are not dead. Good. All right, moving on, 177. So lithophyllon are considered chalices, but they kind of look like plate corals. Yeah, I put my chat crowd to sleep. All right. Which I've said my voice can do, by the way. That's not the first time I've heard that. 178. Blastomusas in general, keep them in low light, lower flow. They tend to do somewhat poorly whenever light levels get kind of high here. All right, next up, 179. Okay, and we're moving on to 180. Is that what number we're on, is 180?
Yep.
Okay, perfect. So, not in this live sale, but possibly in the next live sale, we might be doing some stuff with like decorative macroalgae and possibly with clams. I was able to finally get some decent looking clams. And now we're just trying to make sure they don't all die. Because that's been an issue for us in the past. So hopefully they won't be dead next live sale. All right, next up, 181. Do pipe organs grow encrusting, or can I remove them after some months if I put them between? They don't really encrust. They, although they're a soft coral, they create like what seems to be like a red skeleton. That's what they're kind of named after, is this pipe organ looking skeleton. So it'll always be separate from your rocks. Okay, next up, 182. Is a Paleothoa grandis. Summertime, generally speaking, not great for a lot of corals' appearance. Paleothoa grandis is like the exact opposite. I think it looks absolutely fantastic in the summer, and this is probably as good as it looks ever. That kind of that camouflage pattern on its face changes from season to season. So it's almost like it's just constantly flowing, like billowing smoke almost. Have I seen a Stratosphere Zoa? I have not. Okay, next up, 183. Some Jack Frost Pallies. Okay, 184. These are some Purple Death Pallies. This is the one that people were asking about. Have I ever hybridized anything? I think I did so with this and with a bright green one called a nuclear green. Whenever I eat these espresso beans covered in chocolate, I almost always get like a frog in my throat right afterwards. Okay, next up, 185. Slightly different Purple Death. Stratosphere Zoa. I'm going to look it up right now. Fine. Look it up right now. Do it live. No, it's pretty neat. It's pretty neat. I don't think we've had it before, but I like the look of it. How much are they usually? Probably a lot. Okay, next up, 186. Also, we tend to do a lot less shopping during the summer months, because for the longest time it was like summer is like when everything decides to kind of crawl back and die a bit, and winter is when everything likes to flourish. So we don't do a ton of shopping because it's like we're gonna buy all this nice stuff and it's gonna kind of look like all upset for months, and hopefully it hangs on until like December. So we usually do most of our acquisition type stuff towards the winter months. Lately it's been better. Right, 187. The Fiji Rainbow. Now, I always thought that these guys kind of looked like Bowsers, but that slight difference in coloration and intensity of colors is what makes this guy $35 and the other guy closer to like $80 a polyp. But if you were kind of looking for something similar, this is an option. All right, next up, 188. 300 to 400. Yeah, figured. anytime there's anything kind of new and exciting looking, it tends to get some pretty high price tags. That's just how it is. Okay, $189. These are some lunar eclipse pallies. These guys used to be about $40 a polyp, and there's five polyps on there. Only two of which are opening for us, though. $190. I don't know what these guys are. Not sure. There's a bunch of ones that have either changed color a little bit or something. There's a few of them that I just don't know the names of. Okay, next up, $191. Some red people eaters. What's the most expensive coral that we carry? Probably Acanthophilia. Those tend to be very expensive. They're always in like the $300-$400 range. All right, next up, number 192. Radioactive dragon eyes. So here's the funny thing. Just because like we've sold coral for so long, people always kind of like ask for crazy exotic stuff. But the behavior of the consumer does something very, very, very different. And so like people like hate on some of the things that are more common. Like radioactive dragon eyes, that's a common zoa. Or zinnia, that's a weed or whatever. When you compare like what people actually spend money on to what they say they would want to spend money on, it's completely different. Like people say, I want a bounce mushroom. It's like, no, what you really are gonna buy are eagle eyes, radioactive dragon eyes, and zinnia. And it's not even close. Like the amount of money that people spend on zinnia is outlandish. Okay, next up, 193. I may have known what these things were called at one time, I no longer do. I forget. We have some expensive mushrooms as well. A couple expensive anemones. But I don't think there's anything more expensive than an Acanthophilia here. Okay, next up, 194. So actually, yeah, coral farmers. I know that there's some people that, you know, want to expand what they do in this hobby to kind of grow some stuff in like some grow out tanks on the side. Yeah. Grow some zinnia. That's where all the money's at. All right. Not 195. These are some cotton candies. They're kind of all facing away, but basically like pinks and purples. Nice striping. If you come to Inner Zoo, you really have to announce it. Yeah, I'll do that. In fact, anytime I travel now, what I should do, unless my schedule is so ridiculously tight that I can't even like fit in meals, I want to start doing meetups, because I mean I have a big enough following in enough geographies where we could probably have like a get together at some place and just like you know, just meet up for like, at the very least, just some drinks or something. So if I ever do go to Germany, I'll set something up. It'll be fun. 196. This is a combo of radioactive dragon eyes and eagle eyes, only half of which are open for us. Unfortunately, sometimes just moving the corals from like point A to point B for the purposes of this show makes them really upset with us. Yeah, like I said, if I travel, I should set aside some time for a meetup. And all those ones of people can come and say hi. Next up, 197. But no, it's been really cool. Like, for example, usually it's after the fact that it's like, oh, I didn't realize that you were in blank location. And some of them are in pretty like wild places. Like, I've had, you know, contact with some people in Singapore after I had left, because we were only there for like 3 days. But somebody was like, yeah, it's like, I'll, you know, let me know the next time you come back to Singapore, because I'll like show you around. And that's coming becoming more and more commonplace. I think I'll just like set up something in advance. Next up, 198. Here's some mellow yellow zoas. These are very bright fluorescent yellows. Okay. A lot of things don't glow yellow quite like these. Funny you mentioned Boston. We were there 6 months ago, something like that. How long ago? Yeah, we were actually in Boston. What were we there for? Oh yeah, we were like my dad's former professor was having a big birthday party. Yeah, at UMass. Yep. Let's go to 199. Yeah, so we were there for that. I spent a year or two, I think, living in Amherst. That's and before I moved to Ohio. I was like a little kid, like 5 years old or something. Okay, next up, 200. Oh, there's like a lot of mellow yellow zoas. Where else did I live? Before Massachusetts, I lived in Canada. We were in Montreal. Boy, that I lost my French accent. Go figure. I was 3 years old. Okay, next up, 201. Use some Twizzler zoas. The thing I miss most about like the whole Boston area is like how good the seafood is. Like just being on the water like that, it makes such a huge difference. Like here in Ohio, we don't have seafood worth anything. Some Fruit Loops. Actually, that's a really cheap price for Fruit Loops now that I think of it. Don't know what I was thinking there. All right, let's move on to 203. Here's some Leonardos. A lot of polyps on that one. Yeah, we're gonna get done well under the whole 3 hour thing. We're gonna be done in like 2 hours and 2.5 hours probably. Okay, so 204. Are the Eagle Eye Zoas. Little upset looking. They'll be alright. Again, that, by the way, all this talk of like the super expensive Zoas and stuff like that, that right there, the Eagle Eyes, are the biggest sellers. The most common best sellers. Ever tried sea urchins? Yes. I have one. It's in a 300, it doesn't really do anything. I almost killed it by accident. Okay, number 205. Let's go to 205. So these are some really upset looking Fiji hypercolors. Whatever happened to that nano that you'd polish and everything? I think somebody purchased it. I don't really set up nanos or anything like that. 206. Here's some Rastas. I don't know, for whatever reason, a lot of our Zoas today are just not opening up. Alright, 207. Oh, this one's open. And as soon as I say that, go to the next one, and he's like open. Maybe just a couple of them. Yeah, I've never been into the whole nano tank thing. I know it's like super popular, and a lot of the guys that help out here like and have nanos, but I've just never been into them. I mean, even like a 60-gallon tank, I think, is just too small. 208. Pink plasma zoas. I always kind of like these guys. Like, they have kind of have a green skirt, and you can see how like the skirt kind of glows. And that speckled face. 209 is also a pink plasma. Blowing through these zoas. Okay, 210. don't know what these are. And I don't even remember where we would have gotten anything like this. They're kind of curious because it looks like an eagle eye, except that it doesn't have that really bright orange center. Instead, it has like a red ring. Do you diffuse the sunlight in the greenhouse? We diffuse it year-round, not just in the summer. And we use all these different types of shade cloths. My favorite being what's called aluminette, which is kind of neat. It's actually made of metal. Let's go to 211. These are fire and ice zoas. Aluminette is neat because in the summertime, it deflects a lot of just a lot of the radiation up and away. So it never really gets through down here. But in the wintertime, everything here radiates infrared. So what happens is it radiates upwards and usually just like lost to the atmosphere. But by having it under like this metal canopy, all that infrared gets shined back down and helps passively heat the greenhouse in the winter months. Helps. Okay. 212, don't know what these guys are. I should. They're probably on the website at some point, but I just don't remember off the top of my head what these guys are. They're pretty cool though. Q13 Fiji Hypercolors. A little happier than the other ones. So these guys are closed up for some reason. When it comes to growing stuff in a greenhouse, there's certainly things that do better than others. So if you're ever looking to do something like a greenhouse, don't expect to keep every coral happy. It's just, there's so many variables that go into what things are gonna like that, it's so to try to control everything, it's really challenging. But I would say that about 80% of everything we keep here does really well. Like really, really well. And it's that last 20% that's not ideal. Okay, 214. Use some green people eaters. And that goes back to the whole thing. It's like, can you grow coral in sunlight? Of course you can. Again, low bar for success. So I mentioned that it's like it's been bright and sunny every single day, and it's also been a thunderstorm every single day. I'm getting this feeling that as even though it's sunny right now, we're gonna have an explosive thunderstorm in about half hour. I can just feel it. All right, let's go to 215. What's the difference between zoas and pallies? There's just some like physical differences. Perhaps the most telling is that paleothoas will incorporate substrate into their bodies. I can also just tell just by kind of like looking at their tentacles and stuff like that. But the big giveaway is that zoas do not incorporate substrate into their body, whereas paleothoa do. Okay. And you know what? We are at the very last item. The last item here are some Asterina snails. You can get 30 of them for $25. All right. All right, guys. We are done in record time. So thank you so much. Say my thanks once again to the Patreon crowd. So thanks, Phil, Nathan, Louise, and Jeff. Thank you so much for your donations, and thank you guys for joining in. It's always fun. Don't have the next one planned, but you know what I should do? I should just make like a year calendar and just think ahead to when I want these things and just like stick to that. Because what I eventually want to do is do our regular once per month thing, but then add in a couple for like special events. And we've done that only so far for Halloween, but I'm trying to brainstorm some special event ones. So hit me up on social media or something if you have any suggestions for different holidays. And they don't all have to be American holidays either. Obviously, I have a very international crowd and chat. So we can try different things. All right. So thanks again. And I hope you guys enjoy the rest of your weekend. Bye.